Good morning, dear participants, and welcome to this module. The previous module had reviewed Bua's analysis of myths surrounding womanhood, as she had discussed in the first volume of The Second Sex. Today we shall look at the second volume, which investigates how the lived experience, which also happens to be the title of the volume, of women affect their social and emotional upbringing. In the second volume, Bua has focused on the social indoctrination of women. She has traced their conditioning through their childhood, adolescence, youth, and old age. She illustrates how women at every stage are forced to abandon their claims to transcendent and authentic subjectivity in favor of the acceptance of passive and alienated role, surrendering the active and subjective to the men. Scrutinizing women's lives in various roles, for example, the role of a wife, a mother, and also a prostitute, Bua shows how women are reduced to monotonous existence. In this slide, I have discussed the outline of the second volume. It is divided into four parts, and except the last part, Part 4, the rest of the parts are divided into several chapters. Chapter 1 in Part 1 of second volume discusses the childhood. Bua analyzes how differential treatment towards girls and boys impacts their perspectives towards the rest of their lives. Though infant girls and boys apprehend the world in similar ways, they are quickly sexually differentiated, treated differently by family as well as other social organizations. And girls are raised firmly and gradually to follow certain traits we associate with conventional femininity. One is not born, but rather becomes a woman, is the most iconic sentence in the history of feminism and gender studies. It epitomizes Bua's conviction that womanhood is not innate in a girl, rather it is taught with the help of subtle conditioning. Tracing female development through its formative stages, childhood, youth, and sexual initiation, Bua shows how at every stage of her upbringing, a girl is conditioned into accepting passivity, dependence, repetitiveness, and inwardness. Denied the possibility of independent work or creative fulfillment, she must accept a dissatisfying life of housework, childbearing, and sexual slavishness. At this point, we can also clearly discern the difference which Bua has from the Freudian approach. Whereas Freud had believed that women think in certain ways because of their anatomy, Bua had believed that they learned to behave differently owing to their socialization. And she explains that girls tend to show the same aptitudes and attitudes as boys until the age of 12 or so in their lives. But differences in treatment and expectations grow throughout childhood and increase sharply at puberty, carving different personality types. As the boy grows, he uses his body as a tool to fight and dominate the nature and his surroundings. On the other hand, the girl is taught to make herself other in order to please, and in turn, she herself is treated like a living doll. As Bua has mentioned, those girls who are either raised by their fathers or on their own, they persist in acting autonomously. However, often such girls are socially castigated and harshly reprimanded. They are a cause for suspicion, and therefore they may also become uncertain, sometimes even rebellious and often angry. The future of the boy is open, while the girl has only one future, to become a wife and a mother. With puberty, the insults of a girl's body are compounded. She is made to think of her body as unclean and passive. Sex and puberty for girls are associated with pain and shame, secrets of sexuality and also of pregnancy frighten her. The Second Sex was published in 1959. However, we find that in an interview in 1975, Bua had once again asserted her stance on the socialization of girls. Even though she does not refuse biological differences between sexes, she still emphasizes the role of social and cultural forces that enforce different ways and life patterns on different sexes.
On n'est pas femme, on le devient.
Oui, c'est en somme la formule qui résume l'ensemble de mes thèses. Et ce qu'elle signifie est très simple, c'est que être femme, ce n'est pas une donnée naturelle. C'est le résultat d'une histoire. Il n'y a pas un destin biologique, psychologique, qui définisse la femme en tant que telle. C'est une histoire qui l'a faite, d'abord l'histoire de la civilisation, qui a abouti à son statut actuel, et d'autre part, pour chaque femme particulière, c'est l'histoire de sa vie, en particulier c'est l'histoire de son enfance, qui la détermine comme femme, qui crée en elle quelque chose qui n'est pas du tout une donnée, une essence, qui crée en elle ce qu'on a appelé quelquefois l'éternel féminin, la féminité. Et plus les études psychologiques sur les enfants s'approfondissent, plus il est sensible, plus on voit avec évidence que vraiment le petit bébé féminin est fabriqué pour devenir une femme. Il y a là-dessus un excellent livre qu'une Italienne vient d'écrire, Elena Bellotti, ça s'appelle « Du côté des petites filles », et on montre comment déjà, bien avant que l'enfant ne soit même conscient, on inscrit dans son corps, dans la manière de le faire téter, de le porter, de le bercer, etc., etc., on inscrit dans son corps ce qui plus tard apparaîtra peut-être comme un destin.
Les différences biologiques qui sont évidentes, vous considérez qu'elles ne jouent pas de rôle dans le comportement ultérieur éventuel de l'individu?
Je pense qu'elles peuvent en jouer un, si, elles en jouent un, certainement. Mais l'importance qui leur est accordée, l'importance que prennent ces différences, vient du contexte social dans lequel elles se situent. Je veux dire que, bien entendu, c'est très important qu'une femme puisse être enceinte, avoir des enfants, tandis que l'homme ne le peut pas, ça fait une grande différence entre les deux. Mais ce n'est pas cette différence qui fonde la différence de statut et l'état d'exploitation et d'oppression auquel est soumise la femme. C'est en quelque sorte un prétexte au cours duquel se construit la condition féminine. Mais ce n'est pas cela qui détermine cette condition.
Mais quand vous dites exploitation ou oppression, ça suppose qu'il y ait une volonté à un moment donné. Ce n'est pas simplement accidentel. Alors est-ce que... Où retracez-vous l'origine de cette volonté sur le plan historique et comment, à votre avis, se manifestait-elle de la part des hommes?
Oh, ça remonte à la nuit des temps. Je crois qu'il faut partir de l'idée que, comme on a dit, l'homme est un loup pour l'homme, il existe la rareté, il n'y a pas assez pour tout le monde. Alors les plus forts, et il y a eu un moment dans la nuit des temps où la force physique, ça comptait énormément, les plus forts se sont appropriés les droits, le pouvoir, de manière à avoir également de la prééminence économique, grossièrement pour être ceux qui étaient toujours sûrs de manger. C'était très visible en Chine, par exemple, où il y avait une grande pauvreté, et on laissait mourir, si non, on tuait les petites filles, et on empêchait les femmes de participer à la production, de manière à ce que l'homme ait vraiment tout en main. Ça a été comme ça toujours, et ça, je n'ai pas le temps de raconter ici toute l'histoire de la femme, mais il est bien évident que d'époque en époque, il y a eu toujours une volonté des hommes de prendre le pouvoir. Je n'en citerai qu'un exemple. Au Moyen-Âge, et dans les siècles, enfin, à la Renaissance, les femmes avaient beaucoup de pouvoir comme médecins. Elles connaissaient des quantités de remèdes, des herbes, des remèdes qui étaient des remèdes de bonnes femmes et quelquefois très valables. Eh bien, la médecine leur a été prise des mains par les hommes. Toutes les persécutions contre les sorcières ont été essentiellement fondées sur cette volonté des hommes d'écarter les femmes de la médecine et du pouvoir qu'elles donnent. Et ensuite, alors, au XVIIIe, au XIXe siècle, il y a des statuts faits par les hommes qui interdisent rigoureusement, sous peine de prison, d'amende, etc., aux femmes d'exercer la médecine si elles n'ont pas suivi certaines écoles auxquelles, par-dessus le marché, on ne les acceptait pas. Alors les femmes, à ce moment-là, se sont vues reléguées au rôle de Florence Nightingale, au rôle d'infirmière, au rôle d'aide-assistante, etc. Et vraiment, il y a des ouvrages intéressants là-dessus. On voit comment il y a eu une volonté, puisque vous parliez de volonté, une volonté des hommes d'arracher la médecine aux femmes. Je pense que si on prenait d'autres domaines, on trouverait tout à fait les mêmes processus. Il y a donc en effet une volonté. Et maintenant, cette volonté n'est peut-être plus de prendre, mais c'est en tout cas une volonté très, très, très forte de garder. Il y a des barrages qui se font partout lorsque les femmes veulent accéder à certaines qualifications ou à certains pouvoirs.
Il y a une phrase qui est intéressante, surprend dans vos mémoires. Vous dites qu'en écrivant Le deuxième sexe, vous êtes aperçu que vous découvriez à 40 ans, au moment où vous l'avez écrit, une situation qui crevait les yeux dès qu'on l'avait aperçue réellement. Alors comment ça se fait que vous, qui étiez une intellectuelle, qui aviez fait des études poussées d'agrégation, vous n'aviez pas ressenti avant 40 ans la condition de la femme telle que vous la décrivez?
Parce que j'ai vécu ma propre condition, qui était, comme vous dites, une condition d'intellectuel, qui avait la chance de faire un métier dans lequel il n'y avait pas de compétition avec les hommes, puisque l'enseignement est ouvert aussi bien aux femmes qu'aux hommes. J'avais eu des camarades à la Sorbonne ou enfin ailleurs, qui, justement, sur le plan intellectuel, me traitaient tout à fait à égalité, donc je n'avais pas senti cela. Comme par-dessus le marché, je n'avais pas voulu ni me marier, ni avoir d'enfants, que je n'avais donc pas amené une vie intérieure, ce qui est la chose la plus écrasante dans la condition féminine, j'avais échappé aux servitudes de la condition féminine. Alors, plus tard, quand j'ai commencé à réfléchir, à mieux regarder autour de moi, j'ai vu la vérité sur la condition féminine. Et je l'ai découverte en grande partie en écrivant Le deuxième sexe.
Parce que c'était à l'origine pas une étude qui était destinée à transformer la condition de la femme, c'était plutôt une recherche intellectuelle.
C'était une étude théorique beaucoup plus qu'un travail militant. Et je suis très heureuse d'ailleurs qu'il ait pu par la suite être repris par des militants, parce que maintenant il joue un rôle militant ce livre. Mais sur le moment, il n'avait pas du tout été conçu comme cela.
The separation between boys and girls is further aggravated as the girl succumbs to the hormonal challenges of the body. She is often in physical pain, emotional distress, and may also experience mood swings. Her life in a conventional family is consumed by waiting for men. Detached from her childhood past, a girl is in a state of discomfort and transition, as instead of pursuing any other activity, her time is consumed only by waiting for men, waiting for marriage. And marriage enables her to realize her sexuality and maternity, as well as it enables her to attain certain social dignity. It also leads, interestingly, to the atrophy of women's intelligence and self-determination, and lures them to using trickery in catching and managing a husband. On the other hand, marriage supplies men with a female other, on whom to take out resentments built up in the course of daily life, thus providing an avenue for male-female tyranny as well as domestic violence. The institution of marriage has evolved since the publication of The Second Sex. Based on an analysis of a mid-20th century life pattern, Bois's work on marriage and household work belongs definitely to an earlier phase of the development of feminist theory. The next chapter, chapter 3, titled Sexual Initiation, examines the asymmetry of male and female eroticism that accounts for differences in initial sexual experiences in the lives of men and women. Bois has emphatically commented that men's anatomical destiny is different from women's, from the biological, social, and psychological points of view. The loss of virginity for a woman is a breaking with the past and usually an experience of physical pain. Culturally too, it is more traumatic because, unlike men, feminine imagination is encouraged to have more romantic proclivity. Finally, there is in the sexual act the danger and life-changing prospect of a child. Although motherhood can be an enriching experience, occupations contingent upon it tend to mire women in activities of imminence, leading to repetitive everyday labor only. It can be noted, of course, that birth control would be legally denied to the French women until 1967. Bois also castigates church for not supporting the choice-based legal abortion to women. The next chapter, The Lesbian, is a testimony to the visionary thinking of Bois. Even though Bois has used the term inversion instead of homosexuality, as it is contemporaneous with her work, Bois's non-judgmental appreciation of the fluidity of gender and the range of accompanying identifications and practices makes her work very contemporary. She views lesbianism as neither a deliberate perversion nor a physiologically, psychologically, or economically determined fate, but rather an attitude chosen in, that is, at once motivated and freely adopted. This choice must be evaluated, as Bua has suggested, according to its authenticity. It can be a mode of flight from one situation or a way of assuming it. Bua has also commented that the great error of the psychoanalysts has been that they have never been able to envisage homosexuality as anything but an inauthentic attitude. Stating that homosexuality is no more a deliberate perversion than a fatal curse, Bua concludes that it is wrong to establish a radical distinction between heterosexual and homosexual. It would be pertinent at this point to refer to an article by Claudia Cart. In her article Lesbian Attitudes and the Second Sex, Cart posits that Bua's assertion that homosexuality is attitudinal leads us to a range of interesting possibilities about heterosexuality, which in her opinion Bua has missed. Cart has commented, and I quote, "A great paradox of the second sex is its failure to draw the appropriately analogous conclusions about heterosexuality." Bua seemed not to see that if homosexuality is a choice, heterosexuality is likewise a choice, unquote. Certain arguments which Bua has presented in this context are to be taken as dated. For example, her assumption that girls who lack conventional feminine appeal to men or possess a dominating attitude are drawn towards homosexuality, more so in the absence of a male attention. The second part of the second volume is the longest section of the book which we would discuss presently, and it summarizes the many different roles a woman can play in society. It is in this section that Bua presents her main ideas. Women are limited in every role they can play in society and are thus forced to adopt certain traits and coping mechanisms that have made them even more inferior in society. Because women cannot be productive or creative, they have to give themselves up completely to serving men and children. As a result, however, most women are left miserable, unfulfilled, and temperamental. Bua draws her arguments from different diary entries of people, contemporary anecdotes, and also from literary representations. She presents the beleaguered state of the married woman as well as the burdens of the married man, developing the view that the failure of marriage is the failure of the institution rather than the failure of individuals. The chapter builds on the organizing premise of the book, the existential understanding that pronounces women's lives cut off from the mainstream of life itself. In other words, a woman as a biological entity and conjugal object is destined to maintain the species and care for the home, which is to say, to immanence, to a turning inward, to an existence bounded by husband, children, and hearth. Bua says that the disappointment and problems for women in marriage, as well as the burdens of the married man, constitute a narrative that quite thoroughly dismantles marriage. She also says that to ask two spouses bound by practical, social, and moral ties to satisfy each other sexually for their whole lives is pure absurdity. Marriage provides for men a perfect synthesis of immanence and transcendence, and these two moments are implied in every living movement for the men. Transcendence, as we have discussed earlier, is the movement beyond the self, the thrust towards the future, while immanence involves the maintenance of the self and the integration of present experience with the past in a repetitive manner. This very access to larger life for the men engenders an inequality affecting both partners. Buhr's analysis of marriage and of the position of women within the institution remains valid in recent critical theories too. Her dichotomy between transcendence and immanence can also provide an illuminating critique of continuing gender inequities in marriage and also in divisions of domestic work. It would be pertinent to refer to Andrea Weltman at this point, who has said that Buhr's existentialist ethics not only establishes a moral wrong in marriage, in which wives perform the second shift of household labor, but also supports the need to transform existing normative expectations surrounding wives and domestic work. In the next chapter, chapter 6, titled Mother, Buhr claims that since a woman's body is dedicated to the propagation of the species, motherhood remains to be the natural vocation for a woman. However, human society is never left to nature. She explores the interactions between society and maternity that treats the notion of natural as a problem with respect to the lives of women. The reproductive function for a very long time has not been a matter of pure biological chance. Legal, moral, and emotional conflicts generated by abortion in Buhr's days, including prospects for added danger, shame, and anguish over the illegal abortion, represent some examples. However, Buhr has been able to demystify motherhood by presenting women's experiences of pregnancy and mothering in all their difficulty, complexity, and ambivalence. To her, pregnancy is a drama playing itself out in the woman between her and herself, promising the woman a new existence and also a social justification of her existence. Like the woman in love, the new mother feels needed. Maternal love, as Buhr has suggested, is perhaps more difficult as there is no reciprocity. Her freedom consists in expecting no compensation for the gifts she bestows. She also suggests that birth control and abortion rights, challenges to what she saw as the cult of motherhood, are essential for women's liberation. She resented the religious arguments routinely given against the legalization of abortion. Though Buhr is in no way a gender essentialist, in the current theoretical atmosphere, her insistence on the importance of physiology is more critical than ever. Several of her concerns echo in the 21st century philosophers like Anne Belsamo and Rosie Bradotti, whom we shall take up in detail in later modules. Buhr's views on motherhood and mothering remain underappropriated when it comes to both feminist metaphysics and feminist political priorities. Buhr continues this argument of a married woman's life in the next chapter titled Social Life and examines the ways in which family is connected to a larger community, usually a group of people who are socially similar to themselves. It is usually the man in the family who is connected to the community because he is a producer and also a citizen. It is the wife who assumes the social duties. It is in the process of maintaining a social life that certain objects like clothing, household furnishings, the fact of throwing elegant parties, exhibit public statements about the family's wealth, taste, and social status. Friendships among women born in this situation present opportunities for complicity. An affirmation of their common universe is sought in the exchange of recipes and household hints. They often share sexual secrets, tales of adultery, and admissions of frigidity that negate male sexual domination. These women are joined in their objectification and gather to construct a counter-universe, and a specifically feminine moral code. In chapter 8, Bua discusses how historically prostitution has been the outlet for male sexual energy, even viewed as a necessary means for preserving marriage. Bua has categorically stated that the prostitute is the sum of all types of feminine slavery at once. She anecdotally illustrates the prevalence of the abuse that transforms a young girl into a prostitute. She notes the moral and psychological circumstances which make her life wretched, and also mentions other factors like drug addiction, alcoholism, humiliating medical checkups, violence by police as well as by the customers, which further objectify her. Bua describes not only the prostitutes, their humiliating conditions, their relationships with pimps and other women, but also the courtesans or the hetairas. In contrast to prostitutes, courtesans or hetairas can gain recognition as an individual, and if successful, can aim higher and be publicly distinguished. Bua posits that these women use not only their bodies but also their entire person as exploitable capital. She also explores the notion of freedom for a woman whose role as expensive sex object is a professional choice. This woman's freedom, despite financial independence, cannot be equated with the male freedom of transcendence, as her whole subjectivity is rooted in a man's desire and follies. After having discussed women in their roles of mother and also in the role of a prostitute, Bua now looks at the condition of women who are getting old. In her 9th chapter, titled From Maturity to Old Age, Bua looks at this movement from maturity to old age, which for women registers a jarringly abrupt change in her opinion. She states that while the male grows older continuously, the woman is brusquely and physically stripped of her femininity immediately. She is also susceptible to questionable authorities at this stage of her life. For example, faith healers, prophets, charlatans. A woman's situation changes as she ages. It is quite possible that her husband is alive and is likely to be at the height of his career. She is no longer swayed by public opinion, and she avoids things she had once valued. For example, beauty treatments, social obligations, etc. If she is sympathetic to her daughters, she attempts to live vicariously through them. Elderly women also find serenity near the ends of their lives. Many, having married older men, outlive their husbands, and they come to cherish their independence and develop a kind of cynicism born of having seen it all. But according to Bua, the greatest freedom an elderly woman can achieve is the stoic defiance or skeptical irony. At no time in her life does she succeed in being both effective and independent. At a much later stage, Bua further approaches the subject of old age of women in her work Coming of Age, which was published in 1970. It is an inimitable study of the scandalous treatment of aging and the elderly in today's capitalist societies. The next chapter, chapter 10, attempts to grasp the eternal feminine in her economic, social, and historical conditioning as a whole. Bua feels that this conditioning is the reason for her facing several indictments, for being considered argumentative, for being considered as petty, selfish, lacking a sense of truth, accuracy, and morality. In this chapter, Bua summarizes how women's situations in society impact their characters in general. She has claimed that woman's situation is not a result of her character. Rather, her character is a result of her situation. her mediocrity, complacency, lack of accomplishment, so-called laziness, passivity, all these qualities are the consequences of her subordination, not the cause. She also says that women's situation has remained largely the same throughout history, leaving her oppressed and unequal when compared to men. It has a corollary in her character also remaining the same, as a woman's character is shaped by her social situation. Before explaining what the present situation of the independent woman is like, Bua concludes by analyzing why women often lose themselves to narcissism, love, or mysticism. In chapter 11, titled The Narcissist, a woman is seen both as subject and object. However, she can never be joined as a whole. Narcissism is an attitude that emerges from women's oppressive social situation. Bua defines narcissism as a process of alienation in which women view themselves as an object and place a supreme value on their physical being. As Bua has already established, women cannot exist as subjects themselves, so they seek transcendence by losing themselves in something else. For some women, this something else is the object that they represent in the society. A woman gives herself sovereign importance because no important object is accessible to her. She may cultivate a personal style in her clothing or in her surroundings, and may engage in passionate and unusual interests designed to represent rather than occupy her. But Bua cautions us, it is a failed hedge against objectification, and it does not work, since this woman is simply creating and recreating herself as object. Authenticity is lost in the love of the mirror image. Thus, she is a pretense of a subject. She performs a subject she can never be. Narcissism is thus, in a woman, the apotheosis of immanence, the ultimate predictable retreat from objectification, and also the failure of this retreat. In the next chapter, The Woman in Love, which is the 12th chapter in this volume, Bua claims that the word love does not have the same meaning for both sexes. Women believe that love means total devotion, that is, a devotion of body as well as soul. However, for men, the woman they love is merely one value among others. This difference is not a law of nature. It is a matter of difference in situation. Man is ambitious and reaches out. Woman chooses to lose herself in another. This loss is her freedom, and love is her religion. In this chapter, Bua studies some of the ways in which women reinforce their own dependency, and they are narcissists, women in love, and mystics. All these three types of women embrace their immanence by drowning selfhood in an external object, whether it be the mirror, a lover, or God. Interestingly, Bua comments that love eventually comes to hold less place in feminine life than husband, children, home, pleasures, social life, vanity, and career. For a woman, rather than fighting on her own account, the easy way out is to seek love. Worn out by her adventure, she discovers years too late that she has taken a wrong path. Unable to see her lover as a man because of her conditioning, she worships him as an idol. And when he fails her, when his faults or vulnerabilities reveal that he is not a god, she loses everything. In her disappointment, she also refuses him his freedom. When a man has had enough, he is comfortable with separation. The woman in love can never give enough. Still, she is not all for him, and strives at least to believe she is indispensable to him. In the next chapter, titled The Mystic, Bua talks about woman who chooses to worship the divinity in God himself and not in men. Although there are men who who make similar choices. There is a prevalence of women who abandon themselves to the delights of celestial marriage. Bua cites the example of a famous statue, the Ecstasy of Saint Teresa, by Lorenzo Bernini, the 17th century Italian Renaissance artist. Like all women in love, Bua suggests, the mystic seeks to forget herself in love, to annihilate herself in achieving ecstasy. They actively apply themselves to self-annihilation by the destruction of their flesh. So the mystic borrows from earthly love both the words and the physical effect. The mystic gropes for the supreme source of value, finding it at times in the figure of a mortal man who holds the secrets she seeks. Such projections of love or erotomania may take either platonic or sexual form. The next chapter, chapter 14, is the last part of the book, and Bua considers how independent women are striving for liberation in her own time. Acknowledging a change in situation for women, she also notes that civic liberties remain abstract only if economic autonomy for women does not exist. According to the analysis which Bua has presented in The Second Sex, a man's advantage is that from childhood, his vocation as a human being in no way contradicts his destiny as a male. For a woman to accomplish her femininity, she is required to be object and prey. The emancipated woman is in conflict. To confine herself to her femininity would be a mutilation, but so would rejecting or refusing to acknowledge her sex. Woman is only equal to man if she is a sexed human being, yet for her the terms are incompatible. A woman who has made herself a financial success is still expected to maintain certain feminine standards, elegant dress, a fashionable home, for example. Whereas a successful businessman needn't be bothered with such things in order to sustain his reputation. Thus, the emancipated woman must adhere to the conventional femininity of her mother and grandmother, and at the same time live and work like a man. The basic terms for women remain different from those for men, even in such cases. Men pursue sexual partners aggressively, for example, whereas, as Bua has argued, a woman who is not afraid of men frightens them and ceases to be attractive unless she is taken by the male. Thus, the independent woman is caught between her sexual and professional desires. Besides that, women's health issues are also neglected at their place of work. There is neither sympathy nor allowances for a menstruating worker. In the chapter on conclusion, Bua reiterates many of her key ideas. She notes that men and women in her day are still not satisfied with one another. Their unequal positions are detrimental for both, and the two genders are still engaged in a combat because they both seek to dominate the other. Bua wonders if people believe that the battle of the sexes is an original curse, or rather a transitory moment in human history. She concludes her work by stating that genuine equality between the sexes would be beneficial for both genders. And she looks forward to a future when women and men are equals. And she concludes, I quote, "To carry off this supreme victory, men and women must, among other things and beyond their natural differentiations, unequivocally affirm their brotherhood," unquote. Since its publication, The Second Sex has generated many debates and deliberations in literary and political circles, and also among feminists. Its contents opposed the social conditioning of girls. It challenged the dominant sexual order and became a clarion call for working towards and realizing gender parity. The iconic sentence, "One is not born but rather becomes a woman," led to academic discussions on cultural conditioning. Her study of myths in which femininity is embedded paved the way for much feminist cultural and literary criticism in the second half of the 20th century. She also laid bare the shortcomings of liberalism, Marxism, and psychoanalytic theories as analysis of the formation of femininity and also of the causes of the continued oppression of women, and set about constructing a systematic philosophical alternative. Second wave feminisms from the 1960s onwards would start pursuing these issues. Starting with social conditioning, the sex gender distinction, and continuing to how sexuality and gender are intertwined, constructed, reproduced, lived, performed, contested, and how elusive both sex and gender can be. More recently, in intersections of female body with technology and new media, Bua's arguments have proved to be of immense significance. In feminism, Bua has earned numerous accolades: prophetess extraordinaire, greatest source of inspiration, and mother of us all. The Second Sex, which Bua's US publisher had declared to be the classic manifesto of the liberated woman, has similarly enjoyed a totemic status. In 1970, Firestone had declared it the definitive, not definite, but definitive analysis of sexism. Several post-feminist scholars and critics have also acknowledged their indebtedness to Bua. It would be pertinent to refer to Sonia Crix here, who in her article, Gender and Subjectivity, Simone de Beauvoir and Contemporary Feminism, makes a case for the philosophical sophistication of Bua's theory of the subject and its significance for feminist theory. Sonia Crix is known for her project on the political philosophy of Simone de Beauvoir. She argues that in Bua's writings, we find a nuanced conception of the subject that cannot be characterized as either enlightenment or postmodern. Rather, it is a conception of the subject as situated. Unlike Sartre, Bua distinguishes two different kinds of relations of otherness: those between social equals and those that involve social inequality. The latter relation, wherein reciprocity is replaced by relations of oppression and subjection, is the condition of woman's otherness. It is not only that woman is the other, she is the unequal other. From this perspective, Bua can accommodate a notion of oppression that denies the possibility of choice and transcendence. Thereby, she radically departs from the Sartrean notion of the absolute subject and instead pursues a conception of situated subjectivity. By rereading Bua's existentialism as dialectical and her feminism as a theory of woman's situatedness, Crux makes a powerful appeal for a more adequate feminist theory of freedom that mediates between action and power, choice and necessity, self and subjectivity. Bua is a philosopher whom we shall be referring to in several contexts in subsequent discussions on gender. In the coming week, we will look at the ways in which the lived experiences of women are intertwined with class, race, and economy, along with some other factors. We will further discuss the new and emerging concepts in gender studies in the 21st century, and additionally explore the impact of race and gender on women's socialization, with the help of critics like Crenshaw, bell hooks, and Audre Lorde, among others. Thank you.